waste any time. I'm Dr. Dinesh Talwar. I work in Delhi in Center for Sight. Poonima has done a great job of telling you what are the kind of abnormalities that you can have in OCT in the retina when you do it for the retina. Now, what do these abnormalities mean? We were going to only discuss that now. Let's start from the beginning. We will use the OCT not only for diagnosis, we will use it for guiding our treatment, we will use it for guiding our follow-up, and also for prognostication. Let's see how. Now you see over here, this is an epiretinal membrane here. You see this line on the surface? So this is the retinal surface, you see the membrane, and you see the foveal contour is blunted. So this is an epiretinal membrane, some blunting of the foveal contour is there. It could cause some visual effects. Now, you see here, you see all the layers are intact. The ELM, extra limiting membrane, external limiting membrane, the ISOS junction, the RPE. And look over here what's happened. This outer nuclear layer has atrophied. It's fallen down. Why? And you see this associated? The photoreceptor layer is gone. The ISOS junction is not intact. And so, in this situation, there is likely to be a visual deficit. So if you find a visual deficit, this is why he's complaining. Even in this now, otherwise it looks like the foveal contour is there. But if you look at the fovea, there is thinning over here. So the photoreceptor layer has been lost. This patient too, this is foveal atrophy is occurring. This would happen in patients who are having early geographic atrophy. These patients will also have an effect of the vision. Now, that was a loss of the layers, so that it became thinned out, but you could actually have a disruption. Now, when you have a disruption and you see there's traction over here, this traction has caused a tangential force which disrupted the entire macula, causing a macular hole. And this is what happens when the macular hole is repaired following surgery. Now, the kind of repair of these layers, the external limiting layer and the ISOS junction will determine the kind of vision return that you will get in your patient. What about this? These are undulations. There's no active CNV. This is a dry ARMD due to fairly large drusen. And what about this? Here, what you see. Now, when you talk about CNVMs, they can be type 1 when they are under the RPE. They are type 2 when they are above the RPE. And they are type 3 if they arise in the substance of the RPE. Here what you see is it's arising above. You see this? It's arising above the layer of the RPE. This is a type 2 CNVM. And here, now let's see the follow-up. What happened? This patient was treated by PDT. And see what happened. The entire lesion vanished. So you know your lesion has responded very well to your treatment. So how your patient is responding, the OCT will tell you, but there is a little bit of hypertrophy left as the consequence. Now let's see over here. Here you have an occult CNVM. You have an RPE detachment, but over here you also have, if you look carefully, you have a small neurosensory detachment. So it's very important when you do the OCT to go through the entire sequence of the macula. So either you're doing rasters or you're doing radial, go through all the lines. Don't just see in one area, you know. It's like this entire carpet is there. There's a patch over here. I take my study from there. Nothing is going to come. It'll look normal. So the entire area must be covered before you say there's activity or there's no activity. So this was before treatment. You see what happened after treatment? The fluid went off. And then the patient remained all right for some time. And then he developed what? You see these? These are intraretinal cystic cavities. So in a CNVM during follow-up with treatment, what is happening? He's developed new cysts. Again, activity has occurred. So during your follow-up, you know, now you need to treat this patient once more. This is a patient with a scar tissue. You see this? And you can see the scar here as hypertrophied layer. And you can see the foveal contour is still there. You know, this guy was so lucky, his vision was 612. This is following treatment. So this is, so sometimes you get, now why? Because his phobia is spared. The scar is all over. Now let's see, this is a patient with CSCR and you have a neurosensory detachment, but you also have a small RP detachment and you see there's the leak. You see this leak? It's corresponding to the area of the RPE detachment. So you can even get some idea where the things are going wrong from. What about this? You know, Purnima showed you one patient where she showed you the neurosensory detachment, but also showed you a little irregularity of the RP, which was over here. You see this? So this is a chronic CSR. This happens in the chronic stage. Also happens when pachyneovasculopathy is happening. That means blood vessels have started forming because of the chronicity, right? So this can happen there also. Now see over here. This is a patient who's got a chronic CSR gone into geographic atrophy. Some chorioretinal atrophy is occurring. And because of that, what's happening over here? There is more transmission. You see this? Because the RP is gone, there's more transmission of light. Now when you see this kind of picture, a lot of exudation or it could be a lot of hemorrhages, then start looking. What is the OCT like? Now, you know, otherwise you say you have to do an ICG to make a diagnosis of polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. When there's too much exudation or too much hemorrhage, you're looking for polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. And the OCT, if you have a good OCT, can give you a very good idea. You see this peaked RPD? This is called a tomahawk notch sign. You know, it looks like a tomahawk, okay? This elevation is a sign of peaked PED is a sign that you're dealing with a PCV. This kind of layered, shallow RPD, irregular, and there seems to be another layer below it. That's called a double layer sign. This is suggestive of branching vascular networks. When you have this kind of combination, think in terms of PCV and treat accordingly. And of course, the OCT angio in this case showed that there was actually choroidal neovascularization also. This is another patient who's actually with this kind of picture, with this, even though the SRF was there, should have been looked for PCV, but was misdiagnosed as chronic CSCR. The important thing, sometimes you do a fluorescein angiography, oh, this looks like a leak. It's not leaking actually, if you look very carefully, it's more or less stationary. But the OCT is also scary. It looks like there's a neovascular membrane. But if you see this combination, you see this picture, do an autofluorescence. If the autofluorescence shows hyperfluorescence, you're not dealing with a CNVM. You are dealing with a adult onset vitelliform degeneration. This is where an OCT can sometimes mislead you. So when you have, and you may end up actually giving an injection to such a patient. So when you see this kind of collection, and sometimes you have this kind of collection with a little bit of fluid cavity, what looks like a fluid cavity, it's actually an empty cavity, must do an autofluorescence in that situation. Now this is a patient with a juxtafoveal telangiectasia, and what you see here, these cysts, normal foveal contour, these cysts, these are actually degenerative cysts. These are degeneration of the Müller cells which is causing this, and this is does not need treatment. This is not a treatable situation, right? Now, but on the other hand, if you have a patient, you've done a cataract surgery, and the patient's complaining of vision loss, do an OCT, and if you get these kind of cysts, this is a cystoid macular edema, and this can be treated with NSAIDs and steroids topically. They will respond to that also. And this is the kind of result you'll get. It's a beautiful situation to treat. You know, your value with the surgeon, with the patient will improve. You say, wow, kya kar diya? Itna beautiful. So now, the other situation, a patient with diabetes. In diabetes also, you can get the same kind of cysts. Here you see you have a neurosensory detachment also. And then you can, when you treat them, you can see that this neurosensory detachment also can go away and the cysts also become less. So diagnosis of macular edema, both diabetic, CRVO, other BRVO, you can make with OCT. They look this, and then the sequence of their resolution and their recurrence. So it's important for all these conditions. Can it also prognosticate? Now if you look carefully, You see, these are two pictures. Both seem to show large amount of edema, both diabetics, and with secondary retinoschisis, large cystic cavities. But if you see here, the IASOS junction is missing. This patient will not respond well to treatment. Now you look here. The ELM and the IASOS junction is intact. And this patient did very well after treatment. So this is how you can use OCT for prognostication, not just ki diagnose ho gaya. Now, when you see the edema to be more on one side, and when this is specifically in the vertical scan, now, that means one side up or down has edema. What does it mean? BRVO. You have a BRVO. The side which has more swelling is edema. And once it resolves, supposing it's ischemic, that may become thinner part. So you know that now this is the ischemic component of that BRVO. So the BRVO also you can tell. One, looking at the OCT, you can say this is a BRVO, this is not a diabetic. On the other hand, if this was in the horizontal meridian, that means it's temporal or nasal, then it could be a diabetic. Ladies and gentlemen, you can see virtually in all common retinal disorders, OCT can help you to diagnose. It can help you to follow up. It can help you to decide whether you need more treatment. It can help you to tell whether your patient will improve more or not. It is the workhorse that we have today. The best thing is it's non-invasive. Half a minute on the machine and you have your answers. It's very sensitive and provides a detailed insight into the patho-anatomic changes occurring. So this is one of the investigations which has revolutionized the management of retinal disorders. If you use it properly, along with the other tests, like I told you, autofluorescence is needed sometimes to rule out. You're not dealing with adult vitreoretinal form degeneration. You will be able to treat your patients very effectively and very cost effectively. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to now invite